6 months ago, I released a video attempting to explain the concept of negative harmony. I was surprised at how many views and comments it received, and I read every comment, responding when I could. There's more information out there now than there was when I posted my video originally, and since then, I've read Levy's book twice, along with a few others. I also checked out several very good YouTube videos and did my best to digest Steve Coleman's excellent work on the topic. In a world today where it seems we cannot have any gray area or middle ground and everything is a binary decision, where people use social media to say things they would never say in person, where you are either with us or against us, I dare to offer up the fact that I have come to my own conclusion on this topic. Remember, it's okay if someone thinks differently than you. Negative harmony is a theory. It's just a theory. It's a proposed explanation. It's not an actual carved in stone matter of fact. Okay, get over the shock. I know it's pretty amazing that someone might think that, given that it's in the title of the book. Now, this whole wave of interest was generated by an interview with Jacob Collier, where we first learned that he and jazz legend Herbie Hancock discussed the topic of negative harmony. Not only is Collier a musical genius, but I think he has a gift with words and explains complex topics in an easy-to-understand manner. In his description of negative harmony and the concept of an axis between the major and minor third of a key was the basis for my first video. But I created that video before I was able to get a copy of the book. So now fast forward 6 months, and having read Lovey's book twice, I see no explanation that matches Collier's interpretation, or for that matter, Steve Coleman's. Now obviously both of those guys are great musicians. They interpret the concept and deliver it in their own way. That's great. But it's still just a theory in my book. Now, the problem that some people have with negative harmony is that it is based on the concept of undertones, which happen to be the opposite of overtones. Overtones exist in nature. You can find them everywhere. They are the basis for all musical tones. Undertones, on the other hand, do not physically exist in nature. They are a theoretical concept. Even Levy admits that they are not a natural phenomenon. Just see page 15 of his book. Now, the idea is that the undertone series has the same intervals as the overtone series, root plus third plus fifth. I'm sorry, root plus major third plus minor third. The intervals here ascend from the root. In the theory of undertones, the intervals descend from the root. Now, what this gives us is C in the overtone world and negative C here on the right. But to us, that negative C really sounds like F minor. We just don't hear chords directionally like this. We can't tell the difference between an ascending chord or a descending chord. Descending from C by major third then minor third gives us an F minor chord. Now, more important in my opinion is that unlike the overtone series, undertones cannot be heard. They don't actually exist. Now, this is a point that supporters of negative harmony usually jump on. The defense of negative harmony is often that you cannot generate a minor triad from the overtone series. Therefore, it's not valid. Another defense is that harmonic theory is not just based on physical phenomenon, but from spiritual principles. Now, I get that music can be spiritual, but the idea is based on emotions, not on physics. So what is the big deal? Where did this idea even come from? So for some context, let's go back and review the history of Levy's book. Levy worked on his manuscript the winter of 1940 and 41. Then World War II stepped in and interrupted the project. Now, Levy's work was motivated by Hans Kaiser's work. Kaiser published his epic textbook of harmonics in 1950. Now, this book is extremely hard to find and very expensive if you do find it. Now, Levy finished his manuscript in 1951, probably motivated in part by Kaiser's textbook being published 1 year earlier. Now, Levy gave out a few copies to his colleagues of that manuscript, but he never actually published the book himself, and he eventually died in 1981. So, the book was finished by Sigmund Levary, a friend and colleague of Levy. So, ultimately, the book that we read, and a short read at that, is the original manuscript of Levy's, edited and enhanced with Levy's many handwritten notes from the original manuscript by Sigmund Levary. And now he describes the book as saying, "The underlying philosophical hypothesis consists in a belief of psychophysical reality of tone, whereby the musical fact becomes a symbol of a physical fact, and vice versa." Now, there are plenty of musical examples throughout the book to illustrate the concepts. It's a short book, 97 pages, just 9 chapters, and the appendices include Levy's notes written in the margins from the original transcript. But it should be noted that this book is not about writing music or finding an alternative harmonic ideas. It's just a book about a theory of harmony, not a proven or time-tested factual text. Now, among the first sentences of the book, Levy states, quote, "The raw material of theories are facts. The raw materials of musical theory is music. Music is not, as some contemporary acousticians would like us to believe, something that happens in the air. It is something that first and last happens in the soul." Now, Levy goes on to explain that in the natural sciences, ratings of theories are based on quantities or numbers, while in music, the ratings are based on qualities. And he says, hence, we run the risk of being subjective. So here are three of Levy's comments on tone. He describes tone as a psychophysical fact that we learn about by studying its structure on the physical level. And to put tones into order by assigning numbers and symbols can be called the musicalization of math. But then Levy quickly moves on, saying his work is not the mathematization of music. Tone structure, specific numbers and relationships, provides norms, and harmonic theory is about harmonic norms. So here's some of the main ideas that have been brought up so far. To me, this is the stuff of academia, where ideas get tossed around, reviewed, and then published. It's a self-described theory. We're talking about psychophysical reality, things happening in the soul, tone being psychophysical. So now, let's bring in a new character to the fold, Paul Hindemith. Hindemith was a brilliant composer, musician, and teacher. He published a series of music textbooks. Book one, shown here, was published in 1942. So let me read the text that appears in the back cover of my copy. Originally published in the 1940s, Paul Hindemith's remarkable textbooks are still the outstanding works of their kind. In contrast to the many musical textbooks written by academic musicians, these were produced by a man who could play every instrument of the orchestra, could compose a satisfying piece for almost every kind of ensemble, and who was one of the most stimulating teachers of his day. It is therefore not surprising that nearly 40 years later, these books should remain essential reading for the student and the professional musician. So, 9 years before Levy published his theory, Hindemith already had an opinion on the concept of negative harmony. And he clearly articulates these opinions in chapter 3 of his book while discussing the minor triad. So Hindemith says, in working with an element type to the principle of gravity as closely as tone is, one cannot simply turn things upside down for the sake of a pretty idea. Every tonal composite is constructed from the bottom up, determined by the nature of the tonal world. Tones obey the laws exemplified in the overtone series, just as the stones piled one upon another to make a building obey the laws of physics that apply in nature. Now here's Hindemith's take on the concept of undertones. The most far-fetched, and at the same time the most interesting explanation of the minor triad, is the one based on the undertone series. The latter is the exact inversion of the overtone series. It seems to me repugnant to good sense to assume a force capable of producing such an inversion. This force would do away with the gravitation that is expressed in the overtone series, and there is no evidence of the operation of such a force. Hindemith goes on to say, this undertone series has no influence on the color of the tone and lacks the other natural advantages of the overtone series, which arise without any artificial help and are available anywhere and any time. He describes this some more and then says, thus, we have no proof of any inversion of the overtone series occurring freely in nature. So, one of the greatest musical pedagogical minds of the 20th century had pretty strong opinions on the ideas of negative harmony even before Levy's book was published. Were the two friends? Did Levy share his work with Hindemith? I have no idea. But in my opinion, negative harmony is just a theory. That's all it is. It's a neat mathematical idea, a way to substitute notes to create new sounds. Furthermore, the concept we're talking about is negative harmony. The book is not called negative tonality. I look at the music world and the music theory world generally through a jazz lens. In that world, reharmonizing ideas, melodies, etc. is a regular thing. When you replace a standard 1-6-2-5 with a 1-flat-3-flat-6-flat-2, are you altering the melody above, or are you just creating new harmonic tension by changing the chords below? This is music theory, and there's tons of books out there on jazz theory, reharmonization, etc. But to me, you're not changing the melody. You don't need to change the melody. You can if you want to, it wouldn't be the same song. But when you change the harmony underneath, you're providing a new harmonic tension for the same original melody. That's, again, another opinion of mine. So for those insist on making both chords and melodies negative based on the negative harmony concept, keep doing what you're doing. That's fine. It's a free world, right? But there are some very cool examples out there. Just feel free to find them. There's lots of other terms that may apply and be equally weighted or merited as negative harmony. You know, some folks feel that negative harmony is very similar to the concept of modal interchange. We also have other musical ideas and tools and concepts out there, such as relative minor, common tones, modulation, inversion, tritone subs, augmented sixths, direct modulation, modes of different scales, major and minor, etc. It's easy to get lost in the weeds trying to just justify negative harmony. The bottom line, if it sounds good, just do it. Play it, write it, perform it, compose it, sing it, blow over it, whatever you want to do. If it sounds good, do it. At the end of the day, I really enjoyed learning about the idea of negative harmony. It got me learning lots of new things. And I really wish I could have been in the room when Collier and Herbie Hancock had that discussion. But after all my own digging, I've got to say I'm with Paul Hennemuth on this one. It's just a theory, and overtones are real. Negative harmony is just a cool idea that leads to some really cool harmonic substitutions. So thanks for watching. Feel free to hit me up on social media or put comments below. And take care.